Lecture from the Department of Philosophy, Christian Philosophy. I'm delighted to welcome this evening Dr. Joshua Farris. He is currently the Humboldt Experienced Researcher Fellow at the University of Bochum. He did his studies in St. Louis, in Louisville, and his PhD in Bristol, a doctor of philosophy, theology, and religion studies. He's a specialist in the intersection of philosophy of mind, theological anthropology, and human origins. He has many publications. One, I would like to mention a few. The one is this Ashgate Research Companion to Theological Anthropology, to which also Joseph and I contributed. And then there is the new book, The Creation of Self, A Case for the Soul, which is visible here on the table. And tonight he will talk to us about ensouled identity, from womb to grave, a philosophical and theological analysis. So welcome, and the word is yours.
Thank you. Well, it's good to be with you. Thank you for coming out. I'm really looking forward to this talk and chatting with you afterwards and discussing some of these issues. So I want to thank you first to the department, especially to Bruno for inviting me, and to Georg and Cassina for their help on this. And thanks to the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation that has given me some space and time to sort of mature some of my writings and works this past year, and to my host, Benedict Paul Gurka, at the University of Bochum. So, the last time I was here was in 2018, I think it was, for the Analytic Theology Summer Study and Conference with Georg Gasser. You all know Georg Gasser, I believe. And that was a wonderful time. In fact, funnily enough, after I got back, I was talking to one of my old colleagues, Jerry Walls, and he would kind of make fun of me because all I would talk about was how great the water was here. So fresh and clean. It's the best water I've ever had. It's the best. I think it is. It's great water. It's good water, no? It was good. I thought it was great. Yeah, anyway. Anyway, he thought it was funny. What's that? a couple of people send their hellos. Joseph, Johannes Grossel, I think you all know him, and Jacob, one of my colleagues at Bochum, Jacob Hess. So I think he studied here at some point. Hesse. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, he says hi. So today, I've gone back and forth on the title, Ensouled Identity from Womb to Grave. I thought that was more scholarly, but from womb to tomb sounds a bit more catchy. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to give a kind of a taste of my forthcoming book, The Creation of Self, Case for the Soul, which is kind of the more mature reflections of some of my thoughts about the Cartesian self and the entailment to creationism, the idea that we are created beings, the idea that we are divinely, directly, and immediately created by God, where God is the terminus of the causal chain, as it were, a position that has been quite common throughout most of church history. It's the most prominent position within Roman Catholicism, as well as within Protestant theology, scholastic theology. And so the origin of the soul, this is kind of coming out of my research at the intersection of personal identity and the origin of the soul. And so there's been some recent developments, especially amongst analytic philosophers who have been developing some of these ideas on the origin of the soul and coming up with some interesting arguments in recent history that sort of I take up and I engage with And at the intersection of kind of the science and theology debates, there's some fascinating things taking place right now in these discussions. And so I advance some arguments for a rather unpopular view, although it's been popular throughout most history, and that's the creationist view, or creationist dualism, you might call it, the idea that we are substances, and we are comprised of two distinct types of substances or property bearers. And one of these is directly and immediately created by God. And I think there's some good reasons to actually affirm that. In recent history, there have been, let me step back. Creationist dualism is not to be confused with what you might think of automatically as some sort of creationist view of the world or the earth, right? It's not really dealing with that. That's not really the issue. This is not a sort of affirmation of young earth creationism or even old earth creationism, progressive creationism, or whatever, what have you. But of course, it's consistent with those views, but there's nothing in it necessarily that entails one or the other necessarily. So it is distinct. In recent history, there have been some thoughtful proponents or defenders of the creationist view. Of course, John Foster's most notably has been the idealist philosopher and dualist of a sort, who wrote a brief defense of Cartesian dualism. And he defends something like a creationist view in a couple of places. Of course, Richard Swinburne in one place in The Evolution of the Soul, he defends a creationist view in one chapter of his book. A bit briefly. Charles Taillefer is another who, at least implicitly, is a creationist of a sort and a Cartesian, although he kind of recoils against the term Cartesian. But there's been a recent sort of renaissance of discussion on the origin of the soul. In fact, there's going to be a collection, a shameless plug, there's going to be a collection coming out this year, or at the end of the year, on the origin of the soul, a conversation where I'll be defending the creationist view, Hasker's defending the emergentist view, and then there's going to be a couple of traducianists and some other views therein. And so, but this is the first book-length sort of treatment or defense of a creationist dualism that's out there. And it's written at somewhere in between a mid-level and academic level. Not really pop level, but so let me jump in. We'll see how much we get into today. I have probably too much to say in 45 minutes or so, but we can always discuss it, and I'm sure we'll probably hang out at sort of the Cartesian claims that I make. But I do want to get ultimately to theology, because that's ultimately what I care about. And I think sometimes the philosophers have to do a bit of ground clearing or table setting to help the theologians do some work. And so hopefully we can get to some of that a bit. I'm certainly interested in thinking about the intersection of philosophy and theology, and I'm still that's still something that is fresh on my mind that I'm working through. As Bruno mentioned, several years ago, there was an edited collection on the Ashgate Companion to Theological Anthropology, which I think is kind of a good, strong representation of both theologians as well as philosophers, where that is at least modestly indebted to or representing the analytic theological tradition, or the recent analytic theological movement, I should say. There's quite a diversity of opinions as well as methodological approaches represented there, which I think was intentional by design. And so we'll talk about that in a bit. I think there's this at the sort of center of this sort of personal identity discussions. I think there's this core notion of subjectivity that we need to sort of get after and we need to think about. We need to narrow in on this nature of the subject and think about the implications from what it means to be a subject, or even, as I'll say later, a substance of phenomenal consciousness. What does that mean? I think there's something here that is often missed even in a lot of the analytic discussions on personal identity, although there's some great discussions out there recently. Of course, the work edited by Georg Gasser is an excellent one. There's something more going on. In recent history, there's been a lot of talk about qualities, quality talk, and a qualitative experience, you might say, or qualia in analytic discussions. And in particular, as there's been this renaissance of interest in a view called panpsychism, right? This view that, there's a variety of different ways of articulating or working out panpsychism, but at some base level, all of nature is at its base, not just physical, but mental in some way, where we have these minds or mindlets or mind-disposed properties or something of the sort, depending on how you articulate that or how you work that view out. But that's become really popular as physicalism has kind of made its way out in many ways in a lot of the theological, science-engaged theological discussions. That view has become more prominent. But qualities really aren't enough, it seems. It seems that there's something else that needs to be said about the subject or the subjective nature at the core of personal identity. And I think philosophy can certainly get us part of the way there. Analytic philosophy even can get us part of the way there, but we need a theology to take us further. And ultimately, I think we need a subject or a substance of those qualities. So we need to think about that more. And particularly, dualists have their work cut out for them to think about this in the contemporary discussions as panpsychism is finding its way into a variety of circles now. And physicalism is finding its way out. There is this common notion of subjectivity that's been picked up recently in a lot of the literature, fascinating literature. And of course, I pick up on it in a certain way in the book, The Creation of Self. But there's others that are picking up on this notion of subjectivity in fascinating ways. Stephen Priest is one in particular, where he talks about and he distinguishes between what he calls the condition mode, the deconditioning, and the unconditioned mode. And he spells this out. It's implicit in his old book, The Subject in Question, but particularly in The Unconditioned Soul, the collection called After Physicalism. And so he talks about different modes or different paradigms for thinking about, particularly in this context, philosophy of mind or personal identity. He talks about these conditioned paradigms or these objectivist frameworks or these, you might think of them as limiting paradigms that sort of close us off to a part of reality because we've conditioned ourselves according to certain methodological principles that are very helpful and good and certainly show signs of progress, but they limit how it is that we understand or access the subject. Priest, I think what he's doing there is quite fascinating in this particular discussion that we're having. Mark Spencer is another. He wrote a recent book last year, fascinating reflection at the intersection of analytic philosophical anthropology and phenomenology, The Irreducibility of the Human Person, where he defends a kind of irreducible subjectivity from a hylomorphic framework, broadly speaking, and within the Roman Catholic tradition. It's a great, fantastic work where he argues that in a similar way as Priest, there's something about the analytic mode that seems to be missing or limiting in a way, insofar as it doesn't quite get at the subjective notion or this subjective core. And so he draws in the phenomenologist to expound upon this notion of subjectivity in a helpful way, I think. I would suggest are sympathetic to Cartesianism, even though Mark Spencer is working within a hylomorphic framework. Jeffrey Mandel is another recent defender and one reflecting on this notion of irreducible subjectivity in the essence of the self. in defense of the simple view, where he argues for a particular kind of view of personal identity, that the personal identity is reducible to some sort of metaphysically simple mind, something like a Cartesian mind, which he defends, but a contentless, or at least a kind of subject that he argues evades the sort of analytic precision that we would often like to have when we're talking about personal identity. I defend something like Medel's view, but something a bit different insofar as I suggest that there is a way to arrive at some sort of sufficient designation of the self, or the as a soul, where the self is just its soul, and the soul is the carrier of personal identity. The core notion of the self being something like a primitive thisness that we actually have access to, and we can actually know it by way of our first person perspective, and I think. I think at the end of the day, what moves me in this sort of neo-Cartesian sort of direction is really kind of Roderick Chisholm's, I think his view is basically Cartesianism is the best view on offer amongst other views that really can't capture this subjective notion. So that's provocative, I know. We'll talk. We can talk. We can discuss that. Yeah. But there are limiting modes, or objectivist modes, or conditioned modes, as Stephen Priest talks about them. The most obvious of is sort of a scientistic or scientism view of the world. But even less obvious, he would say that science itself, sort of the natural sciences, are limiting or conditioned modes, and that they follow sort of certain methodological procedures, and those procedures lead us to certain very helpful, good conclusions, but they often limit our thinking or our vision of what's going on, and particularly in this discussion about the self and the person. With Priest would say that even the analytic mode does this as well, in that it is concerned with means and rationality or reasoning, properties, object thinking, generables, determinables. But when it comes to the actual subject or the particularity question, which is what I really am interested in, is this particularity question, the analytic mode often falls short. So, and these often tend towards some kind of elimination. In the technical sense, we know what sort of an eliminativist is. There is this sort of elimination of the whole discussion within analytic philosophy of mind is about the elimination of qualia or qualitative experiences. And without a successful reduction within sort of the physicalist framework, there is this tendency toward the elimination of qualia, but even more so the elimination of what Priest calls the subject question, the subjectivity. So panpsychism has brought qualia back into the discussion in a helpful way, I don't think it goes quite far enough. Then there's the essence nature of the subject, and I'm suggesting that we need a bit of both philosophy and theology to arrive at an understanding of personal identity. So here's the proposal, and we won't get to all this, but philosophy of personal identity and personal origins leads to something akin to substance dualism, or at least that's what I suggest, and that's what I suggest in the book. Because a substance is required for the properties of phenomenal experience. And even further, which is a common view amongst Cartesians, this leads to a sort of creationist view of the self, or the person as soul, or person as immaterial substance. because the generables just don't quite make sense of or account for the nature of the particularity or the subject in question. This particular view holds to often comes with an objection to substance dualism, which I suggest, well, at this point, we need a bit of theology to help us out. The objection is, well, there's no empirically determinative way to arrive at a conclusion of the timing of ensoulment, right? Because there's no, well, there's nothing about the nature of the soul that is empirically detectable. And so that might be a problem or an objection that has been raised. A metaphysical question, as well as oftentimes it's framed in the sort of moral way, right, which is common within Roman Catholic theology. But then third and finally, I discuss science-engaged theology, or what I'm suggesting is probably theologically engaged science of personal identity. And I think we can, I think there's been a lot of work that's been done recently in empirical work done on dementia patients as well as Alzheimer's patients that are fascinating. But there's a lot there to be mined and to reflect on in terms of how it is that we make sense of persons in light of dementia cases. There are common views about dementia patients that when a loved one is going midway through dementia, there's a tendency to think that, well, the person's not really there, right, anymore. But in fact, recent case studies suggest otherwise. And I think this not only inclines toward a kind of soul view, as I argue, despite the common opinion to the contrary, but it actually unveils other features or properties guided by theology that we wouldn't otherwise arrive at very clearly, or it just wouldn't be apparent to us by just looking at the empirical material. So, ensoulment, origins. I think there's something about the nature of subjectivity that's at the heart of these discussions about personal identity that has implications for the origins of a person's or mental beings. So we need to begin with the necessity of property dualism. The necessity of property dualism. Property dualism is the view that there are two distinct types of properties that are not reducible one to the other. So there's mental properties as well as properties of a physical kind. And there are mental properties in the sense that there are phenomenal properties of experience that arguably, suggestively, something has. There are characteristic properties that describe or distinguish the two types of properties, at least two types of properties, and that is the characteristic properties of consciousness or phenomenal consciousness, the properties of access or having private or privileged access to one's own mental states, which seems to distinguish between, well, these two types of properties that are hard to sort of either reduce or eliminate or to kind of excise from our ontology. And then also there's intentionality. Foster, in his book, Defending Cartesianism, he works through a variety of different options as he's moving in the direction of some kind of property dualism. And he works through a variety of different physicalist options. And he argues that there is no way to make sense of or to reduce the properties of a phenomenal kind to the properties of a physical kind. It is, we can't do it. And there's a reason why there's been this trend away from physicalism in recent years towards something else like panpsychism, or even more recently, something like idealism, which is quite an interesting development in recent years in the analytic discussions. So he sums up his argument in this way. He says, quote, "The token identity thesis claims that each mental item is identical with a neural item. The prima facie objection to this, as we've seen, is that we simply cannot understand how things of such seemingly different types can be identical, an objection which gets reinforced by Kripke's modal argument to the effect that the psychological character of a mental item is essential to it, but not to its neural correlate. First, he might adopt some form of analytic reductionism, claiming that the psychological concepts applicable to mental items are to be analyzed in wholly non-mentalistic terms, mindless ways, in other words. The main option here would be that of analytical functionalism. Second, he might endorse the type identity thesis, claiming that the psychological character of a mental item is to be empirically identified with some aspect of its physical character. Thirdly, he might embrace the view of the metaphysical reductionist, conceding that the psychological character of a mental item cannot be specified in any but psychological terms, but insisting that the item's possession of his character is derivative from and nothing over and above certain non-mental facts about it." And so Foster shows in quite a detailed way that none of these approaches is successful and that the objection to token identity stands. And what seems to follow is this fact that there are these undeniable distinct types of properties, or a kind of property dualism, something that recently Richard Fermerton in his book, Dualism, A Case, Knowledge, A Case for Dualism, fantastic book, he argues extensively for something like this thesis, that there is property dualism, it's unavoidable, and the physicalist options on offer just don't quite meet up. They just don't adequately account for the types of properties that we have access to. And so he argues for this sort of epistemological dualism that is Cartesian in nature. Right, so he summarizes his argument here. He says, "I've argued that there is no denying the fact that there are phenomenally given properties that resist classical reductions to physical properties. Moreover, our phenomenological acquaintance with such properties gives us both propositional knowledge that such properties are exemplified, and also the capacity to represent directly such properties are exemplified, and also the capacity to represent directly such properties in thought. I've conceded that there is an odd sense in which one might still find room for such properties within a physicalist worldview," although he's certainly not hopeful throughout his book. "The reconciliation will not be attractive to most physicalists, for it gives epistemic and conceptual," this is the important point, "epistemic and conceptual priority to the phenomenal. But there is the epistemic possibility that the very phenomenal properties that the physicalist wants to reduce to paradigmatic physical properties are, one, the realizers of the dispositional properties that define for us physical objects and their properties; two, properties that are co-exemplified by the same processes that exemplify intrinsic physical properties, whatever they are; or three, properties exemplified by the state of affairs that it is the exemplification of those intrinsic physical properties, whatever they are." And so Fermerton makes this argument, or this case, that, well, at least after working through all the physicalist options on offer, we don't have a physicalist option that actually gives priority to the phenomenal, but it's by way of the phenomenal that we have access to, or knowledge of, at least immediately, knowledge of physical objects in the world. So there's a really, really odd, queer sense in which he says, well, maybe a physicalist could make sense of this. Maybe a physicalist could give priority to this sort of phenomenal set of properties and make sense of this sort of property dualism. There are views that are attempting to do that, but doesn't seem like a very successful route because of the inversion of the sorts of priorities given to the distinct types of knowledge. So Fermerton works through different theories, as I do in the book, that arguably won't do the trick when it comes to the nature of the phenomenal properties, as well as the subject underlying. Bundle theories won't do the trick. One of the famous thought experiments is, quote, let's suppose for simplicity that there are two and only two people in the world, you and I. We exist at the same time, have various perceptions. I'm in pain while I have a visual image of a red apple. You experience euphoria as you have the visual image of an orange. The bundle theorist says that the pain and the visual redness go together to make up me, while the euphoria and the visual orangeness go together to make up you. Why is that true? What do the redness and the pain have in common that makes them both my experiences? End quote. And I think this is an important point to point out that there's different thought experiments we could put forward and we could think about and we could spend more time on. But there's something about the nature of the physical that doesn't seem to give us determinate knowledge about the subject in question. Screen went off. Oh, it startled me. Yeah, it's fizzy water. Okay.
The good one is here.
Oh, okay, just straight out of the faucet. Yeah, that's right. That's the best. At least I remember it being the best water. I'm not used to, in the States, I do drink it sometimes, but it's not as common to drink carbonated water, at least where I'm at, as still water. So it still surprises me on occasion when I'm in Europe.
There's something missing on the bottle.
What's that?
There's something missing from the bottle.
Yes, that's right. Yeah.
No, it's a tropist.
What's that?
Ema has tropist intuitions.
Yes. Well, maybe it'll come on in a moment. I can continue talking or try to remember what I was going to say next. Okay, good. Cool. Yeah, I mean, we could run through various thought experiments, like the teletransportation thought experiments. We all know this from the Star Trek shows. Everybody knows Star Trek, right? No? No, they don't? You guys don't know Star Trek? Oh, okay. Yeah. So there's the teletransporter where there's a breaking down of the bodily molecules and then the transference in a much more quick and efficient way to another place on another planet, and then the reconfiguring of the molecules to make up the person again. And those types of thought experiments go to motivate the same sort of point that Fermerton tries to make about physicalism regarding the phenomenal and even regarding the phenomenal subject, of which he's less clear about what the subject is. And that is that there's something about it that seems indeterminate. There's no criterion or way to arrive at a criterion that makes determinate. what is sufficient about the body itself that makes you you. And of course, there's other thought experiments out there, like various arguments for mereological replacement. There's no garden variety object in the physical world that we can point to and say, hey, that's you, that's me. There's something about the fuzzy boundaries of physical objects themselves that don't seem to sufficiently give us a description or an informative content about what it means to be me and what it means to be you, right? The physical just seems inadequate. Physicalist theories just seem inadequate, as Frumerton is pointing out. And of course, the same is clear on what is commonly attributed to John Locke in his compresence theory, that there's something that is needed, even something like a substance, of which Frumerton is reticent to go in that direction. We'll talk about that in just a moment. Well, what about causal theories? Causal theories have been proposed as ways of physicalist ways of making sense of phenomenal properties. But again, there's something about that too is insufficient for designating phenomenal properties. Just because a phenomenal property is triggered causally by physical properties or by neural events doesn't mean that there is an identity relation between them. And it seems, in fact, there isn't an identity relation between them. So causal theories also arguably go both ways. But this final reflection by Frumerton pushes him toward this notion of substance. It pushes him to consider the possibility of a substance of a particular kind, a substance of phenomenal consciousness, of which he is resistant to affirm because of his radical empiricism. But he comes drastically close toward the end of his book, Knowledge, A Case for Dualism. Well, this raises another issue when we're talking about the nature of the subject itself. Bundles don't seem to give us a sufficient way of individuating or demarcating the person as a substance of phenomenal consciousness. And there's a related issue here that really pushes us to think about the nature of the origins of persons, as substances. And that is the perfect duplicate problem, which renders both the physicalist ontology as well as a bundle of, if you hold to a bundle, a property view of bundle of immaterial and or mental and physical properties, seems to be insufficient and seems to render those ontologies insufficient for accounting for the subject or the substance in question, which Frumerton all but states explicitly. There seems to be this prior thesis to personal identity, prior to the parts, prior to the bundles, prior to the bundle of thoughts, the bundle of experiences, the bundle of properties, generally speaking, prior to the generables themselves or the determinables. There seems to be this particular that makes sense of the generables or the determinables that we have, the structure or the property, the structural properties that we have. There seems to be something prior, and there seems to be something that is prior that actually unites the properties and makes determinate the fact that you are you and you have access to the fact that you are you. I think we do, but that's an open question. So we are something like an immaterial substance that is described or characterized by these sorts of properties that we've been talking about. So here's the solution seems to be something like a substance, but not a substance of a physical kind, not substance physicalism, whereas Frumerton seems to have argued quite clearly and conclusively, there doesn't seem to be one on offer that would make sense of the property dualism that he and I sort of develop. And even if there was an odd or queer sense in which you could arrive at some sort of physicalist view, it seems inadequate that a substance physicalist view would do the trick or would capture this sort of phenomena. So Fumerton recognizes the need for substance, but he doesn't quite go there. He doesn't quite commit. He even recognizes the need for something like a primitive thisness or a hexaity, that there is something about the particular that makes that particular quite apart or distinct from the properties themselves. Properties themselves seem insufficient for identifying or individuating persons. But he pushes against that notion. The advantage, of course, of bringing in a notion of substance into his ontology, he readily recognizes very briefly at the end of his book, and it provides a nice way of accounting for, if we were to at least make an argument for the inference to the best explanation, it provides a nice way of accounting for endurance, the enduring identity. It provides a nice sort of binding of the mental or conscious properties. It provides a ground that would not necessarily solve all the problems, but would readily avoid the sort of the problem of inverting the sort of the priority of the different types of properties in terms of a knowledge. And it provides a kind of neat way of individuating the subjects in question. And he even raises the question about synchronic identity. Maybe it can supply something regarding synchronic identity. And I think it can, if we can identify as the person at a time and place and across time, of course. So in the book, I argue for this sort of S set of properties that don't seem to map onto the physicalist or even a sort of mere property dualist. There's something insufficient that they just properties that we've been talking about. I'm going to move on and skip this because I think we're close on time, aren't we? 10 minutes or so. Mm-hmm. So it seems we have good reason, or at least plausibility for affirming something like a substance or a subject of phenomenal consciousness. But not just any old subject or substance of phenomenal consciousness will do. And so there's been some recent developments within the dualist literature reflecting on different types of substances or subjects. And Jeffrey Medel, in his book that I mentioned earlier, gives one type in the sort of broad Cartesian way that he does, that our soul is the carrier of personal identity, and the physical properties that we have, at least when it comes to the subjective core or the notion there, it almost says nothing about it. And I offer something else. I offer a distinct Cartesian view that's similar in some ways to Medel, but something like an informative or sufficient designation. How is it that the soul is different from that soul? Or how is it that your soul is different from another soul? And is there anything that makes determinate that reality? If it's reducible to the physical, or it's reducible to a set of properties, then it seems unlikely that we could get at some sort of individuation of distinct types of souls. So? How do we make distinct these souls? How do we individuate? Well, there's different ways that are offered in the literature. There's certainly contingency individuation, but as we've discussed, for various reasons, that seems insufficient. Again, property bundles seem once again to not supply the sort of sufficiency that we want, or certainly that Cartesians seem to think that we have and want. And then, of course, there's, you could just say it's like a brute fact or something of the sort. Okay. So I offer up something like a primitive thisness, and I raise certain evidences in favor of it.
that at least help salvage some of the problems that are often raised against physicalism or property bundle theories. Right, so coming back, coming around, and hopefully we'll get into some theology. There are implications from this sort of Cartesian or neo-Cartesian approach. Implications within the origins discussion that seems to indicate or entail a kind of creationism rather than emergentism, because as generables or determinable properties are insufficient for designating persons or the particularity concern, so are generalizable processes arguably insufficient for making determinate the origins of persons themselves. And so Cartesians have been inclined to affirm something like a creationist view or a creative dualism, where souls are created directly and immediately, where God is the terminus of the causal chain itself. This certainly has implications, cosmological implications, and it has implications as a kind of bridge to theology, but also has, I think, it provides a helpful space to bridge to these more subjective matters that some of these authors are touching upon in science. So the bridge, there's been a variety of bridge paradigms within science and theology recently. Obviously, there's the bridge paradigm of emergence that's been quite prominent in the recent literature. Of course, there's been variations of panpsychism, reductive panpsychism, as well as non-reductive panpsychism, with very layered laws that give rise to higher order entities in biological evolution. There's dispositional properties, also hylomorphic compounds that have been raised as possible bridges between science and theological discussions, and that I think might be a helpful program. But sort of the Cartesian is and the idealist in recent literature is getting after this other bridge that I think is relevant, and that is that there's some sense in which the underlying reality, the core, the prior, is the mind, and that's the bridge in contrast to these other bridges on offer in the literature. And I think that's the right sort of approach. I think that's the sort of approach we should take, and it has a lot of fruit, or there's a lot that's fertile there to think of and to reflect on. So this sort of theistic or creationist dualism has certain entailments from the argument for the type of individualized soul. It also has creates space for different types of knowledge beyond the empirical or the scientific, beyond the sort of conditioned approach that Priest and others talk about. It opens up revelatory knowledge or unconditioned paradigms, as Stephen Priest calls them, where theology can once again have a place in the discussion, where in many ways it's been set aside. But there's also other benefits. Namely the sort of the revelatory notions of the soul and personal identity that take us beyond the limits of philosophy to theology. So I've only gotten through the first part. Good. Good. I'm going to skip to the third part because I think it's more directly relevant to what we've been talking about as we get into theological matters of personal identity, because I think theology has a real place for filling out our picture of personal identity. But there really haven't been a lot of works done on this from a theological perspective. There was one collection back in 2004, Personal Identity and Theological Perspective. But I think in many ways, our companion kind of improved upon that. So I think there's a lot to be said for this notion of ensoulment at the end of life. And there's some recent empirical studies that actually give us a lot more fruit to reflect on as we think about personal identity. And you might think of this as a kind of science-engaged theology, as that's been quite popular. There's been a growing set of literature out there on that that takes science-engaged theology to be something like theology attuned to the natural sciences or to the determinations of the natural sciences, where the natural sciences prompt new questions and puzzles for theological topics. Obviously, there's a second ingredient that many of the practitioners affirm, that there's a kind of entanglement between theological reflection and science. But I want to suggest this is probably more like theologically engaged science, where we have this empirical material that's really fascinating, but it needs guidance by theology to uncover or unveil the what's going on. So there's this end of life ensoulment, and there's these recent test cases in dementia. There's also been parallel studies in terms of Alzheimer's that are fascinating and raise a lot of, give us a lot of material to reflect on in terms of a theology of personal identity. Well, what are the findings? Some would suggest that the findings entail some kind of physicalism that follows from the fact that we are holistic beings. But I've suggested elsewhere, and this is something I think that's suggestive even in the empirical data itself, taking a kind of inference to the best explanation, that a sort of soul view or substance dualism is actually what's entailed for a variety of reasons. It's the best explanation of the data, despite the common opinion. So dementia and the soul, there's a lot there to think about. Recently, Tricia Williams, following her mentor Swinton, she's done a lot of work in pastoral theology, and she recently published her dissertation on dementia cases within her own tradition, the evangelical tradition. And admittedly, she explores a limited set of patients following from this tradition, but they all exhibit the same sorts of patterns and themes and qualities that are quite important and interesting for theological reflection, not just for pastoral reflection, although it's important for that as well, how it is that we relate to the other person, the patient, but also it raises questions about the nature of identity itself. They all recount similar feelings midway to late in their dementia process, similar experiences, similar prayers that trigger certain experiences or anchors or groundings in their identity. Also songs, while their brain is deteriorating, and while their memories are fading as a result, there's a sense in which, a strong sense in which, when they hear songs, in some sort of effective way, it anchors them in some sort of continuous way with their past selves as they identify with their community of faith. And these are consistent across the patients that she studies. And there's been other studies as well, as I said, in Alzheimer's. So despite their failing body and brain, they continue to experience their faith early, mid, and leading into late dementia, which has profound implications for how we think about the nature of personhood, especially as guided by a theology. So there are certain suggestive lines that seem to make better sense in light of substance dualism rather than physicalism, and that is, well, memory doesn't make them who they are. Neither does cognitive or propositional awareness. They don't have that. So we'd have to broaden our sort of definition of the soul from Descartes' thinking thing, if that's what his definition was. Williams even leans in the physicalist monist literature direction. Well, she affirms something like this, but only kind of really quickly in passing, as she's just kind of relying on a small set of theological literature that's available. She didn't read our book. She would have arrived at a different conclusion. There are features that extend beyond and are inexplicable in light of bodily and neural functioning. And these are strongly suggestive in Tricia Williams and her case studies. So there's evidence of cognitive decline, but simultaneous to cognitive decline, there's evidence of a spiritual heightening during these times, a robust spiritual heightening, and even a robust sort of identity, sense of identity, even though they can't like articulate who they are, or they can't even have access, they don't have access, or they don't have the proposition, there's still this spiritual heightening. There's a kind of remembering, but not remembering, certainly not remembering in a sort of propositional way. There's a different kind of affective or phenomenological remembering. There's even in the experience of ongoing spiritual growth in this or in these these case studies. And there's also a heightened awareness of God across these case studies. Their phenomenal experience is consistent in that they all contend that Christ is my identity. God is with me, even though I can't recall or state who I am. God is still with me. Fascinating. I am a part of God's story. There's a consistent theme across these patients. I feel God when I pray and sing. There's a resonance, even a remembering, but not remembering, as she puts it, of their continuous identity in their community of faith. Rather than a focus on the problem of evil or suffering, there's a sense of a new station in life for many of these case studies. There's a hopeful orientation toward the end, even though they can't recount who they are. In one sense, there's this eschatological focus that is a big part of their identity. So there are specific case studies. I think we're running out of time, so I'm going to move along a little more quickly, wrap it up.
Yes.
I've summarized this, but these are specific case studies from those. So what can we say about, a summary of our summary of reflections on these dementia case studies? Identity is rooted in some way in faith and community. There's a broadened sense of identity that a theologically guided reflection on these case studies gives us. Identity is something effectively known, even without awareness of propositions or the ability to articulate those facts. There's an identity that is, again, non-dependent upon the neurology, as signifying transcendent features of identifying with God and others. There's a phenomenal knowledge, again, that's confirmed or reaffirmed as giving precedence to knowledge of physical things. And there is this prior identity thesis, this prior identity to the parts that is arguably highlighted and reinforced in these case studies. So, I think these case studies provide, again, a fertile place to really reflect on the theology of personal identity in a way that hasn't been done in recent academic theological discussions, and fill out a sort of this notion of subjectivity as the core of personal identity, and I think complements a conception of personal identity that is, well, really intuitive, that we've discussed already to some degree. So I'll just leave it there. And I think there's plenty there to reflect on and for us to even discuss.
Thank you very, very much for your presentation. Very interesting. And I'm sure there are many questions. Please. Joseph.
Your approach, very interesting, especially when it came to the end of life stages.
In the end, you had these cases where you described the situation of dementia patients, and you said, it was the last slide before this one, identity is something affective known without awareness of propositional. I wonder whether this is really an argument for a Cartesian approach, or because a Cartesian approach is really a kind of reflexive awareness approach, and you showed very well that in these late stages patients or persons don't have this reflexive awareness anymore. It's more an affective awareness of their identity, and this for me is more evidence for that identity might be something non purely based on something not purely mental, but more on something which we called embodied or something connected to the body. Because if you speak about affection, feeling, and so on, I have more or something in mind with this connected to the body and not so much to the to mental properties. That is only a question.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yeah. So I think obviously this part needs to be spelled out a bit more, but I do think there's something obviously about the complex sort of personal identity views that seems to be presumed here as not being the sort of best explanations for the continuity of personal identity or even personal identity at a time, as not being explained by the sort of generable properties. In this case, I think so I'm putting this forward really as more suggestive reflections. I have my commitments, and I think they make sense of the kind of problems that we see with property bundles, as well as problems with perfect duplicates that Cartesianism seems to be the best explanation for. But in this case, with these reflections on these dementia cases, I think it more readily indicates a kind of soul or ensouled identity. So there might be, I think there's something there more to reflect on more. Maybe we could argue back and forth whether or not something like a Thomistic dualism would do a better job than Cartesian, which I know you would be inclined that way. Yeah. That's a good question, though. Yeah. I don't have it. There's things we could reflect on, but I don't want to belabor it. But we could, I think there's something there to reflect on further and flesh out in more detail.
Thank you. My question concerns your concept of souls. So, according to you, do souls have any essential properties?
They do. Putting that on there, I opened myself up to attack. I should probably just avoid that altogether. You're referring to the bare particular language, of course. Yeah, I mean, the way that I understand bare particulars is not that there's no essential properties, but there is. Well, I don't know that that's necessarily incoherent. There's been some. I'm not an expert on this issue. There's been some recent. Writings defending bare particulars of the sort of more extreme sense of a bare particular. I would hold to a bare particular in a more modest sense, right? That there are essential properties, but those are not kind of makes sense of the particularity of the person itself. But there are essential properties. So I'm holding to a more modest view of bare particulars, if that works. Yeah, I'm not holding to a strong version of bare particulars.
But this is the standard view of bare particulars, is particularly without any properties.
And yeah.
It's an argument that such a substrate has no essential properties.
So this is a common view.
Yeah.
This is a common view. This is true. It's true. Yeah, I mean, I think. It's a fair question. I'm holding to a more modest view. I don't want to commit too strongly to bare particulars, or certainly to a strong version of bare particulars in the way that you're suggesting. There's challenges with that, and it's commonly perceived as being an incoherent idea altogether. Sure. I'm not sure that it is, but it's commonly perceived that way.
Just to add to that, so Martine Niederrümelin, who's also a substance dualist, holds a simple view of personal identity. She seems to me that she defends something like a bare particular view of subjects, because she basically says that none of the psychological or physical properties I now have are essential for me. I could change all of these properties and still be the same. And she actually says that I could become an elephant. I could have elephant experiences, because an elephant also is a subject of experience. So it's not just me having an elephant body, but it's me being an elephant. And I'm wondering, if you go that route, whether you aren't led in a similar direction.
Well,
if you
the first part of what
kind
you
of
said,
simplicity and particularity and thisness, hectitas.
Yeah,
and then I'm wondering,
that's a good question.
Why I should, like, what do these souls have to do with me as a historical being with a, like, expectations and plans and a history?
Yeah, so that's a good question. That's a big multifaceted question. The first half of what you said about Martina, I think I've read a couple of her papers. I was very sympathetic. I'm very sympathetic to that, what she's saying. The extreme implication that you raised, that we could actually be elephants, that seems ridiculous, right, at one level. Right, you would agree, right? Yeah, and I would agree too. I think, I don't think the way I develop a soul lends itself to that. I don't think it goes that far, I do think there is something about the nature of contingent events that don't make us who we are, in one important sense, at least. They're still important. Like, our narrative identity is important. Our historical conditioning is important. Our origins are important. They certainly provide a structure that to our souls that Swinburne picks up on in one of his chapters on the evolution of the soul. I think that's really important. It's significant, obviously, to the redemptive narrative of Scripture and how it is that we identify with our redeemed selves. That's all extremely important. But in a similar way that, like, there's no way to make determinative the timing of ensoulment based upon these generables that you're kind of talking about, and these properties of bodies and things like that. I think there are, still generables, and there are even still essential properties that contribute to our soul that we can't just, in one sense, ignore. The timing of ensoulment is kind of a related problem that you're kind of touching on, I think, in a way, because there's nothing determinative about the nature of the soul's identity that can be empirically detected in terms of its time. And we didn't get to that, but that's where I make a sort of there may be suggestive ways from the empirical data that we could suggest that the soul is there at this time, like what Thomas Aquinas says, what Swinburne holds, or that the soul is there at the moment of conception, that there is a soul in the embryo. There are things that we can say about that. But I think there's a more decisive way, at least as Christians who affirm a theological tradition, and this is kind of the line that I go, the direction that I go in, that makes determinate the fact that we are ensouled at the very conception of life because of Christology. If you affirm the dogmatic tradition, then not only is Christ the moral exemplar of all humanity, but he's the normative exemplar. And in the Logos' assumption of human nature, he doesn't ever just assume a partial human nature. He assumes a full human nature. Otherwise, we would have the heresy of Apollinarianism. And so I think there's a dogmatic way to affirm that or to beef up this notion of identity that is... That can't be arrived at determinatively by way of empirical arguments or by way of even the analytic method. Does that make sense?
Thank you very much for your talk. I really enjoyed it very much. I believe almost everything what you have said. We want to explain personal identity, of course, we have to refer to subjectivity, irreducible subjectivity, of course. And physicalism, neither physicalism nor trope theory, bundle theory can do the job in explaining. This is absolutely clear. But must the subjects, these irreducible subjects, really be substances in the sense of Cartesian substances? This is my question. Pardon?
He's agreeing with you.
Oh, thank you very much. Because as we all know, since our lecture in Introduction of Philosophy of History, Cartesianism also has some minor disadvantages. So for instance, the psychosomatic unity per se, of biological persons, of human persons. This is really a problem for substance dualism in Cartesian sense, and also the bare particular matter. So my question is, what are the arguments, your arguments against taking forms, individual forms, in the sense of hylomorphism, also in contemporary hylomorphism, for explaining this irreducible subjectivity? This is my question, because also individual forms can do the job of principles of identity and unity, also of synchronic, diachronic, crossword, transverbal identity. They can do also these jobs, individual forms. So, to put it in a nutshell, what are your arguments against individual forms of moderate contemporary hylomorphism in favor of Cartesian dualism?
Yeah. Well, I think there's several things that could be said there. One is the way that I'm thinking about, or the way that at least I developed this sort of property dualism, this sort of epistemological dualism that is strongly Cartesian from Richard Fermerton. I think it leans in the direction of Cartesianism as a
as a kind of substance dualism, unless you want to go an idealist direction, which I'm open to that as well, a kind of analytic theistic idealism. But I think it leans in that direction, and I think that provides the best explanation of this sort of epistemological dualism that I was sort of attempting to lay the ground for, and that Fumerton argues in his book quite well, and that I argue somewhat in my book. And I think it leans in that direction, and it's made best sense of by a sort of Cartesian view, given the nature of epistemology and the relation, the implicit relation that seems to have, that I was suggesting or leaning to or pushing us toward these sort of metaphysical ideas or conclusions that Fumerton himself leans in the direction of. He just won't go there because he's an empiricist. So I would say, in part, that's part of what's leaning me there, and I think it does a better job than hylomorphism or even Thomistic dualism. I'm much more open to the project of Thomistic dualism than hylomorphism in general. Second thing, I still don't understand what hylomorphism is. And so maybe it's a deficiency in my understanding. Some days I still struggle to understand hylomorphism. Third thing is this, and I think this is the more important issue. There's something about hylomorphism that relies, it depends on the version, again, seem to depend upon some sort of complex view of personal identity, and seem to depend upon sort of generalizable events that God has sort of designed in the world to give rise to these substances. That's why there's a lot of the hylomorphists today that are defending hylomorphism are defending a kind of either a version of emergentism, mm-hmm. arguably, right? I know there's debate about that. Mm-hmm. Or they're affirming something like a kind of traducianism where the soul has parts that can come together and give rise to a new soul, which makes sense of this generalizable process. And a lot of them see this as a benefit because of, you know, biological evolution. It makes sense of that data. But then again, it seems to rely once again upon this sort of generalizing, this generalizable nature of the person that's defied when we try to get at this sort of subjectivity notion or particularity that's not accounted for on its own system. The bigger picture, and I think I move in this direction in making this argument, that they still rely upon this sort of logic that entails a kind of perfect duplicate problem. And that seems to me to be a problem with hylomorphism. And so There's other scientific problems that I have with hylomorphism, at least as I understand it. There's so many complex ways of articulating hylomorphism. But the underlying sort of physics, if hylomorphism is right, it seems to entail this idea that there are hylomorphic compounds all the way down in the biological world, right? And in which case, there are more complex hylomorphic compounds on the way up in the biological hierarchy. And so these higher up complex identities are emergent or something, depends on how you work it out again, emergent or something upon these lower level complexes or hylomorphic compounds. And I don't think most physicists actually affirm that particles, for example, are hylomorphic compounds. Furthermore, it doesn't seem to me that, well, in terms of quantum mechanics, when we think about the base level of particles, that they are hylomorphic compounds. And if they are, then we have this sort of generalizable process, this possibility, this conceivability, that these hylomorphic compounds could be, in theory or in principle, perfect duplicates at some level. So that doesn't seem to work for me. It doesn't seem to work to make sense of this core subjective notion.
Thank you. I have to start out, I'm no philosopher, I'm a dogmatic theologian. So that means on the one hand, probably I couldn't follow all the intricacies of your philosophical argument. But on the other hand, I'm especially interested in your theological implications, of course. And I have so one question that might latch on to what you just said, because at some point you said the panpsychic approach was promising, but you didn't want to go that way, but you go the creationist way. And to me, the argument why you do that was not clear. So from the theological school or thinking I come from, with reference to Karl Rahner, there is this idea of a self-transcendence under divine influence that he uses to explain evolution, and that some other theologians suggested also to explain how the soul comes about through human procreation. So you don't need a direct creation, but you need this self-transcendence under divine influence. So first question, what would you think about that? And why don't you think it's not promising? And the second is just a comment. Actually, I didn't plan to post that question, but your answer to Daniel's question before kind of irked my objection, because I cannot follow you with this Christological argument. I would just say, if I'm not arguing for it, but if it should be the case that the ensoulment took place sometime after conception, and if Christ took on this human nature, then human nature would be that it takes place sometime after conception. And then it would not be Apollinarianism, it would just be... I'm just making an argument to say that Christology does not allow us to make such inferences. We have to clarify anthropologically what being human means, and then we can Christologically infer, and Christ was exactly that in his human nature. But the other way around, I don't see how it should work, actually.
Two big questions there. I'm really glad the dogmatic theologian came. That's why it's hard to give these sorts of talks, because it's hard to bring sort of more particularizing, sort of detailed arguments with broad sort of theological development, which I'm interested in both. And often these two types don't discuss, and analytic theologians even become just other philosophers who don't engage with other sources of knowledge. So I'm glad you came. So that's good. To the first question, I think I like Karl Rahner for one thing. I do think that the transcendent features make better sense of, are made better sense of in a sort of Cartesian frame. But in terms of the origin question, there is this sort of Mystic understanding of divine action that I can't make sense of, but I kind of map it out in my religious studies article on emergent creationism as one way to make sense of emergentism that's also creationist in nature. And so if you hold a sort of this is common in theological literature, if you hold to a non-competitive view of causation between divine causation and secondary causation or immanent causation, then you can say both things. You can have your cake and eat it too. In other words, you can say that there are these immanent processes that give rise to these generalizable events that are law-like or lawful in nature. And you can also say that there's some mysterious, unique sense in which God created it that way, created the soul. So you could still like have your cake and eat it too and call yourself a creationist. I don't know about that view. I mean, it seems strange to me, but it seems to make no sort of, there's nothing distinguishable about or discernible even about the nature of divine causation on that view that can kind of be pointed to and say, yeah, that's a distinct divinely caused event, the nature of the origination of your own individual particularizing soul. That seems it seems to once again to depend upon a sort of generalizable process that defies, is like somebody like Stephen Priest would argue, that undermines the whole sort of particularizing or subjective notion that can't be generalized and couldn't even come about in a generalizable process. And this is where some sort of robust theistic dualism comes into play and kind of makes sense of what we all really care about at the end of the day, and that's the person. Not a perfect duplicate, as if we could make any distinction between, on that view, a perfect duplicate and two identical selves. There would be no fact of the matter distinguishing those two realities. But we care about the individual, the particular, not about what they look like, sound like, you know, act like, behave like, neurologically, how their brain functions, but there's something underlying that prior to that that makes sense of them. You could make sense of, like, there have been recent Thomists who have argued that Thomas was a kind of occasionalist. I know you guys don't like that. Yeah, probably, right? I think we've talked about this years ago, Bruno. But there are some who say this, who argue this way, like Brian Lefthow has argued this way as a Thomist. And that would certainly be one way of making sense of this sort of emergent process that where God creates the soul directly and immediately. And at least empirically, what seems to be the case is really just a divine causation. So I'm trying to partially answer your first question. I don't know if I answered it fully, but your second question, I think it's a little easier. Did I not answer it? Oh, I did? Okay. So the second question about the Christological argument, obviously I ran over that pretty quickly. I think there's a dogmatic principle at play within the tradition, it seems to me, that whatever God assumes that he saves, right? There's this principle that's dogmatic that's in the background and in the conciliar reflections, the sort of crystallized conciliar reflections that affirm that Christ is that the Logos assumed a full human nature, and to do otherwise would be heretical. So Apollinarianism seems to follow, well, it would follow, if the Logos only assumes a part of human nature. And so he has to assume the whole human nature. And that's where we can make determinate or say something decisive about the nature of anthropology via Christology. Because he is a complete human being from beginning to end. And if he were, impregnated, if Mary were impregnated by the Spirit and the Logos assumed a partial human nature, then we would have a heresy. But dogmatically, it seems that can't be the case. If it's not the case, and there's this normative principle at play in how we think anthropologically, that is made determinate by our Christology, if in fact we affirm that dogmatic tradition or we're within that dogmatic tradition.
Just a question of understanding, if I got it right. So your relation between this philosophical approach and the theological approach is a systematic one. So you introduce creationism, or this creation of the soul, as a kind of anti-reductionist argument. So creationism follows from your non-reductionist approach. That is what I understood. And right. Just I want to know whether I'm right or not.
Uh-huh. That's correct. Uh-huh. Yes.
So thank you very much for this inspiring talk. Thank you for your questions. Announcement for the next week. Next week we will have again a public lecture here. Sophie Grace Chappell from the UK will be here and talk about epiphanies. So we are heartily invited to join and have a good evening. Bye. Epiphanies.